now joining us is a gentleman by the name of Sandy Pensler. Many of you probably have heard of him or seen his commercial. Sandy is running in the Republican primary for the U.S. Senate seat that is now held by Debbie Stabenow. And he is running in that primary against John James, a business person from the Detroit area, as well as Bob Carr, an historic preservationist. Thank you very much, Sandy, for coming on air today. I appreciate that.
Thanks for having me.
Well, I know from the perspective of economics, you graduated from Yale University with a BA in chemical engineering, economics, and an MA in economics, as well as I think you taught some courses at Harvard, undergraduate economic courses. So you know quite a bit about economics from the standpoint of academic as well as application of it, because you run a business, correct?
Correct.
And what is that business, and how big is it, just to give people a perspective?
Well, we have a variety of businesses. I buy troubled companies and ones that have had announcements that they're going to be shut down. So there are six different companies that we have. The largest is a detergent manufacturing company, and that one has four plants, a few hundred people working for it.
So it's of considerable size, and that's really all I was getting at. So you not only have the academic, but you have the actual application of economics in the everyday business. In that respect, then, one of the points I was interested in talking to you about when hearing about it is the tariffs and your thoughts on tariffs in general, and then the tariffs that President Trump has proffered due to the industries that were crushed by particularly China and other countries?
Well, in general, tariffs are generally a bad thing because they limit the trade and different countries going into comparative advantage. But that's in an ideal situation where there are a whole bunch of reciprocal conditions. That's not what we have. What we've got is really an abusive situation that's a result of a policy of America trying to open up markets around the world for really ever since post-World War II period and being willing to take bad trade deals to do it. So with China in particular, we sell them $130 billion of goods and we buy $506 billion of goods from them. In our biggest arena, just as an example from a Michigander's point of view, there's a 25% tariff on U.S. cars going into China plus distribution limits. And if China wants to sell them to us, there's a 2.5% tariff. If Ford wants to open a plant in China, they have to have a 50% Chinese partner or any of the other U.S. manufacturers, and they have to have a technology agreement that effectively transfers over all of our intellectual property and technology over 5 years. They come here, they can buy it, no partners, they can set up no partners, and we protect their intellectual property. These are just crazy deals. So Trump is trying to pressure them and change them. And I think just the facts are so strong, there'll be some to-ing and fro-ing between the countries. But in the end, just like he recently did in South Korea, we'll end up in a much better situation than we did before he started the process.
On air with me is Sandy Pensler. He's running for the U.S. Senate seat, currently held by Debbie Stabenow in the Republican primary. So, Sandy, if you were to then, it sounds like, win in the Republican primary and then beat Debbie Stabenow in the general election, you would be supportive in the context of which you just laid out, the tariffs in which President Trump has applied?
Absolutely. I think you also have to look at the Chinese tariffs in a broader sort of geopolitical standpoint, where we're having a negotiation with Korea to end their nuclear program, which has huge consequences to us. And really, the lifelines to North Korea are China and Russia. And Trump just reached out to Putin against his advisors to bring him in, and he's getting a lever with China so that he can use those, I believe, to trade for support to denuclearize North Korea. So this guy, as in several other cases, is three steps ahead of everyone. And yes, I'd support him.
It's interesting you bring that up, because separate of this, earlier I spoke about, I forgot what made me bring it up, but he's crazy like a fox. And I think what is happening, so many people rip into him about him being un-PC or not PC and not presidential-like. I don't really care. What I am interested in, and I'm assuming you, especially being a businessman, is you're interested in results. And that's what matters, not how people do it or what they say, as long as it's legal, but results. And you're right. He's thinking long ball. I don't think he cares so much. Oh, what is this not a political thing to do? And he's thinking long ball, and he's thinking it's like a chess game. I'm doing this and this move because I want them way over here that has nothing to do with it to do that move. Is that your thought process on that, Sandy?
Yeah, I think it's actually more than that. People want it. They're getting really what they wanted in large measure. He's a bull in a China store. And Washington has all these old traditions and paradigms, like with trade, that we really have to break free of those old traditions because we have abusive arrangements. A good example, again, because we're Michigan, cars with Japan and with Germany as well with trade, we have huge imbalances with Japan and with Germany. And we need to push back on them. We sell more than, we buy more than twice as much as they buy from us. And then we support their military so that they have a military umbrella that Japan pays nothing for. And Germany has a military umbrella. They agreed to pay more than twice what they're paying, and they aren't doing it. And they take advantage of us on trade. Well, that all comes out of Michigan. So I think it's terrific what he's doing. I think the results so far on things that matter, like employment, like growth in the economy, are terrific. And there's a lot of distraction on some of these other things that really, to me, do I like them? No, but they're noise. The stuff that matters, the substance that's changing people's lives, that's been terrific. And that's what I want to see first and foremost from the president. So certainly I would support those policies.
On air with me is Sandy Pensler again. He's running for U.S. Senate, the Senate seat that Debbie Stabenow currently holds, and he's running the Republican primary. And I wanted him to come on and give us some thoughts on certain things. He's given us certainly the geopolitical thought and business background when it comes to these issues with him, with trade and tariffs. And in fact, and correct me if I'm wrong, Sandy, but a lot of what we're not saying, a person like myself is not saying that we need to make these trade agreements or we need to have these trade imbalances balance. No, we're talking about free trade. If you're going to charge us 25%, why are we only charging you 2.5%? Let's get rid of the same old song and dance. Because not just to get rid of it, because it's not working. These people don't do what's best for America as a whole. They don't even care about working with each other any longer. I gave you the whole DACA deal where President Trump said, oh, you want X? We'll give you X plus triple. And then they're like, oh, he caught the left with their pants down. And they're like, oh, whoa, I know we asked for X, but and you're offering X plus triple, but we want X plus, 10 times more. Because they don't want to solve the issue. So it's the same old song and dance. And something I want to get to real quickly, and then I'll move on with some other questions on air with our guest, Sandy Pensler. And that is something I kind of got cut short because of my hard break last segment. We're not trying. Tariffs are not necessarily there to balance the trade. It's to make it an even trade field, an even field for trading. If people want to buy more BMWs that are come out of Germany because they're a better car than something here in the United States, that's all fine. But we have to make it an even level playing field. Would you agree with that, Sandy?
I think in general, yes.
Yes. Okay, now real quickly, on air with me is Sandy Pensler. He's a candidate for the U.S. Senate seat currently held by Debbie Stabenow, running in the Republican primary. He has two opponents right now, Bob Carr and John James. We spoke about the tariffs issue, and Sandy, you gave us your background, which comes from a business academic and actual, and more so, from actual application. You've been running companies for quite a long time now. If you're elected as our next U.S. senator, and again, that's what all of you who are listening to me need to judge. Who do you want to vote if you're going to vote in the Republican primary? And if you are then elected, you win the Republican primary and then go on to beat Debbie Stabenow in the general election in the fall. What would be some of the issues you want to jump on and work on and advocate for fairly quickly?
I think the three are, just have jobs, jobs, jobs. It drives purpose and meanings in people's lives. Continue to work on streamlining taxes and decreasing regulation. Continue to try to push to improve education so that our kids, which in Michigan have been falling behind lately, can be prepared to have those great jobs. And to do that, we really need competition in schools through choice. We need to provide incentives versus just seniority pay. And I think we need to continue to reform entitlement policy. We've got a crazy entitlement policy that's in the U.S. that feeds into dependency, drives dads out of homes and impoverished communities. We got to put people to work, and that's what I think the Trump administration's been doing, rather than just giving out handouts that really hurt people in the long run rather than helping them. It's got to be a springboard to a job, not a long-term dependency.
You mentioned that one of them would be taxes, and you mentioned, obviously, what President Trump and the Republicans have done so far in the tax reform, and it appears to be working. We'll see what happens in the long run. What else can be done in that arena around taxes?
Well, I think that the tax code can continue to be simplified. There still are far too many brackets, loopholes, special interests that are being provided for. There's still a billionaire tax loophole that, frankly, many of my friends take advantage of. That provides a special tax rate, a capital gains rate for buyout funds and hedge funds. I think there are a lot of simplifications and loopholes that can be done, gotten rid of in the tax code, and I think it can be streamlined there.
You know,
to continue to reduce overall rates.
I don't disagree. A lot of us just got done doing our taxes, and if you don't use a tax software, which I do, but I had to use, I couldn't use it for my daughters who worked in Georgia for part of the year, and she was there co-oping down there, and it's a state, their state form for a person who just made, you know, a straight money that has no deductions, no anything, took us over an hour to do. It's so ridiculous out there. I know Michigan is much better than that, so I'm there with you on that one. Let me ask you real quickly, which phrase best describes the legitimate or, let's say, legislative powers of the federal government with you? So let me repeat that. Which phrase, I'll give you three phrases, I'll repeat them. Best describes the legitimate legislative powers of the federal government. Expressly delegated is one. Expressly delegated. Two is few and defined. Few and defined. Three is numerous and indefinite. I think this will give you, my listeners, an idea, because you're running for a U.S. Senate seat currently held by Debbie Stabenow. So which phrase best describes the legitimate legislative powers of the federal government? Expressly?
I think it's the expressly delegated is what it should be, because we have a system that things that aren't expressly delegated are retained by the state.
Good. And I think people will get a bigger, broader idea of how you would govern or help lead and govern with that question being that you believe it is expressly delegated. Real quickly, where do you stand on border security? And that's a big issue with Trump and in the quote unquote wall, whatever manifestation that wall takes.
I think he's on to something that we need to do. We can't just keep letting in millions of people illegally in the country. I think he also, it's a broader issue, is on to something that when he says, I want to increase the skilled people that can come in through H-1B and decrease the unskilled people, because on average, it cost us about $250,000 net to support unskilled immigrants that are coming in from the border, especially, and it's even higher if they're illegal. So the shift, as Canada has done, that allows skilled people to come in has driven their economy, and I think the shift that he's focusing on is right for the country.
One last question, and that is healthcare is very big, as we've been speaking about. It's taking kind of a backseat, but it's still looming out there for many of us. Where do you stand on Obamacare? Would you vote to repeal it if a vote came in front of you? And if you would, then what would you want to see us move towards replacing it? Or if you wouldn't, why and what would changes would you make to it?
In a second, we should repeal Obamacare. It's a disaster. We need to have, this is the critical issue to controlling our deficits. Is we need to get more market-based systems where consumers are empowered to choose and that they have economic benefits to choose and incentives, and suppliers have incentives. We have the incentives all wrong in healthcare, and we've got to get those costs under control, got to get rid of Obamacare and provide incentives to consumers and suppliers to hold down costs. And if we can do that, we can fix the deficit. If we don't, we just won't have a chance.
All right. I've hit the end of it. Thank you very much for coming on air. I appreciate that, Sandy. Have a great day and good luck. That was Sandy Pensler. He's running for the U.S. Senate seat that currently Debbie Stabenow holds, and you may well have a chance to vote for him in the Republican primary. Lines are now open. You're listening to Live with Renk.